Hello, everybody, and welcome back to the second day of the AVGL College Smite Championships. It's the start of our gauntlet round, and we're going to be starting off in the Ragnarok Conference. My name is J-Mac Tucker, and alongside me for this afternoon is Gore Miser. How you doing, buddy?
I'm doing great. I'm really excited to see what exactly we're going to see come out of this, because, I mean, this is the beginning of the gauntlet. This is where teams essentially have to prove themselves or they're out. And honestly, there's a lot on the line for them, and I expect to see a lot of high performance just because of that pressure.
Wow, and taking a look at the picks and bans already, Hoonbots and Ratatosker taken off by Calvin College, and the immediate respect ban taking Serket off the table. Bowling Green University, they don't want to deal with that Serket yet again, but that does leave Thanatos open, and that's going to be going the way of Ajax.
And Thanatos is just one of those gods that you do not want to deal with. Letting that through, I think, is actually going to be a big thorn in their side, just because he's going to be very potent as a jungler. He's going to be very potent early on, and that's, of course, still the name of the game right now. Being said, Serket, I have seen perform very highly, so I can respect the fact that they want to ban it, but I feel like it was a huge oversight. As right now, I mean, Kabrakan being hovered over, and still, I mean, someone that we've seen kind of picked up lately, very strong in the jungle, very strong as a solo laner, so nothing too out of the ordinary for him to be grabbed up.
I mean, more than anything, yeah, Serket is just, you know, a general respect ban. Like, Serket's a really strong god, but more than anything, Ajax just was on a tear yesterday with this god. I mean, I watched him 100-0 two people at the Phoenix in a split second. Hit him with just one Cobra's Kiss into the Deathbane, and they were gone. Over on the opposite side, Bowling Green going to pick up the Kabrakan that will be locked in, and Scotty going to be the Hunter picked up for their team as well.
And Scotty is one of those back-and-forth gods. I think it kind of equates in my head, not necessarily on the same level, but kind of towards the Vulcan, where you can have someone who does incredibly successful things with her. She can do a ton of stuff that other ADCs can do, and especially the split pushing that you can get out of Scotty is going to be great. But on the other side, you can also fall very far behind depending on your matchup. So it's really going to be up to seeing, I mean, who Calvin is going to pick up to kind of counter that, who exactly they think will be able to fight this Scotty match for match. And it looks like they're going to be hovering over that on her right now. And honestly, I love the pick. I mean, on her, he's great at boxing. And Scotty, that's like one of the one things you don't want to do. And on her, I believe, can actually get rid of Calder very fast. So really looking at it, I think Calvin have a very good matchup there.
Yeah, I mean, they're going with their comfort picks. Aside from the Thanatos, they're just running back what they did yesterday to Bowling Green by picking up the on her Bacchus duo lane yet again. Definitely going over to Illion Empyrean. Those are probably two of their better gods. But on the opposite side, Terra going to be picked up, which now leaves the ambiguity between this Kabrakan and Terra pickup, which is going solo, is one going support, is one going jungle. We're kind of left in this state of question here. A Wheelish going to be taken off the board by Calvin College in response. The Sobek was taken away by Bowling Green. Still waiting to see what other bans, probably another big jungle ban.
I was looking at the picks over here for Calvin. I was like, wait, why would they ever want to get rid of the... And then I realized they had the Thanatos already. And I was like, okay, makes a little bit more sense to me. They don't want to be able to give that away because, again, on the other side, it's looking very good as we see, you know, the Sobek banned out. A lot of Guardians on the side. And the Zeus is a very big one. I cannot tell you how, like, insanely strong he has been showing up lately. And getting rid of him, like, I think when we were talking about it yesterday, we were watching the Challenger circuit. It was somebody playing a bunch of Vulcan. They switched to Zeus for a game, and that Zeus game was the best one they had by far. He's not necessarily the easiest confirmed damage, but the Chain Lightning as well as the Shield and his Detonate just allow you to shred through people in jungle camps, at the mid camps, there, and over near the Gold Fairy Harpies as well. And so getting rid of that as well as the Raw, just taking out any mages that might be potent in this mid lane. And it seems like Calvin have a plan going for them, but Fafnir actually is going to be hovered over and locked in.
Triple Guardian comp here from Bowling Green, which makes me to believe they're going to be going with another Hunter for their final pickup here. Fafnir almost guaranteed going into that support role, which means we may be seeing the jungle Kabrakan solo Terra coming out of Bowling Green. Now, option over to Calvin State. They do still need a mid laner, but now more than anything, they need a safe mid laner. They don't want to get somebody who can get picked off super easy. Thoth would be a little bit of a dangerous option here, as Kabrakan can wall him off, make sure he can't get that evade and punish away. So they may need to put their options towards Scylla or maybe some other big mid lane Hunter if they wish to go. While I'm not the biggest fan of Neith, I wouldn't be opposed to it in this comp to try and get away from the rest of Bowling Green.
for me, I feel like it really is going to depend on what they also grab up for their solo lane over here, just because, again, that's going to be a very big impact, because if they do decide to go for the Neath at this point, having a physical jungler as well as a physical hunter, picking up that Xing Chen actually allows them to kind of balance that out. Now looking for their last pick, it could be anything, and it looks like they're going to be opting towards that Medusa right now. It's being hovered over, but again, a Medusa, a Neath, or even a Cupid, which we've seen in the mid lane, but the Medusa going to get locked in right there, and they're going for that. I mean, essentially two Guardians, two Hunters with that Assassin. It's going to look really good. Medusa is going to have a little bit of a fun time in the mid lane, but it's going to be interesting to see who exactly Bowling Green decides to pick to go into that matchup.
Yeah, but the problem with the triple Guardian is it's three very big options for Coco or for Ajax on this Thanatos to go into. Whoever he wants at max rank, he's going to be able to execute them at 40% HP. And on any of these three Guardians, that is a very astounding number. With the Terra up, it's going to be a little bit more difficult because she has that healing built in and really needs to make sure he can time out that Terra's Blessing well just so he doesn't get baited into a shot here. Now Bowling Green looking to opt towards their final pick, still taking some time to think about it as they do still need most likely another Hunter. So we're going to be seeing the double Hunter meta come back yet again. Instead of the triple Guardian on both sides, it's going to be double Guardian on one with that Thanatos. We'll see how it goes. And right now they're opting towards the Ho-Yi.
I really like Ho-Yi being picked up just because I feel like he does have a very strong matchup. The question really is if it's going to be Ho-Yi or Scotty mid, because I feel like both of them have potential in that role. Both of them are able. I think lately I've seen a lot more of Scotty in the mid lane, but Ho-Yi was played there once upon a time and can still do really good boxing matchups, especially with someone like Medusa, who has to absolutely be the mid lane here for Calvin. So it's really going to be interesting to see how they go into that. And looking back at it, you were mentioning the Thanatos. I fully expect them to try and get rid of this Terra specifically because of the healing. I know Fafnir can be a pain in your side, Kabrakan can be a pain, but that healing and that ultimate coming out from Terra, either even if it's just to get rid of the ultimate, it's definitely something worth getting into. And it's going to be really interesting to see how these teams go forward, because usually the benefits of having that triple Guardian is that you are really tanky early on, but Thanatos does not tend to care too much about your health pool.
No, especially since he does have that 10% guaranteed damage off the death scythe in the late game. When you got 3,000 plus HP, he's just going to be shredding that every single time. It's not going to matter. Has that built-in penetration into his kit as well with the Scent of Death. I mean, this Thanatos could potentially be, as you said very early on, a thorn in their side. We'll see just how Bowling Green is going to respond to this hyper-carry assassin into the later stage of the game. Or will the triple Guardian comp be enough to protect their two squishy hunters? We'll find out in our first game of the day. Calvin College and Bowling Green. Not going to want to miss out on this one, so stick around. Hello, everybody, and welcome back to our first game of the day in this best of three set. It's going to be Calvin College versus Bowling Green State University. My name is Jim Mac Tucker, and joining me this set is going to be Gorm Meiser. How you doing?
I'm doing great. And, you know, we covered a little bit during picks and bans looking at this. So one thing I feel like we didn't highlight, and this is going to be something I think is big, because we talked about the Thanatos, we talked about the Triple Guardian. We didn't really look at the Xing Chen as much as I think we should have. And I have seen this guy have such a large impact in team fights lately that if he can get ahead, if Ajax decides to kind of rotate over there and possibly get his solo laner as far ahead as he can, that's going to impact Gold Fury fights. It's going to impact anything that might happen on this left-hand lane if we see those rotations come out. But right now, so far, it just seems like Bowling Green going to be taking a little bit of an advantage thanks to Kabrakan's clear.
Yeah, I mean, the fact that they got that Calder there is you see Ajax actually throwing the Death Scythe onto Calder, trying to get that extra damage out and make sure to kill off the pup so he can get that bonus of damage for his team. And really, this mid lane matchup does go in favor of the Scotty Kabrakan just because of Kabrakan's clear, but Coco and Ajax going to be able to out clear that one for now. Poor little Ajax stuck inside of those Tremors. Coco's going to get a little bit too aggressive here. Calder is available. One more shot. It is open. It's still chasing him down. Not going to be able to get the kill as it's a little too quickly. And Ajax going to be able to keep his teammate alive by pressuring them out.
I like Ajax's presence of mind to continue that aggression there. He didn't turn around. I mean, Calder was one hit away. If he turned and hit that, it might have made a little bit of a difference. But knowing his teammate could outrun that and be able to kind of turn around and put the pressure down onto Bowling Green and force them to stay under the tower so they couldn't get ahead and come out and try to kill Coco's guns there, it's going to be very big to them. It's really all across the board. It looks like the mid lane is going to be the one where it's coming out the biggest of a wash for everyone. I think right now we see Calvin taking the lead over in the duo lane, and it seems like we have Valby Spin having a little bit of fun over there in the solo lane as is Xing Chen.
I think this is the first game in the entire championships, and probably in most of the AVGL, that we're seeing zero invades right now. Nobody. Nobody's going for a purple invade. No one's going even for a speed invade right now. They're all going to their own respective buffs. I think this is a first.
Well, Calvin was able to steal away the small harpies from Bowling Green earlier. On the duo side, I saw that Anher and Bacchus both walking up there, but they hadn't stayed around. They didn't stick around too much. In fact, I think they actually saw the rotation coming out from the duo lane and immediately were ready to drop that as soon as they saw that. And like you said, I mean, everyone's kind of paying their respects. They're not over-aggressing here because they recognize how important this is. I mean, it's a best of three set, but even if you lose that first game, mentality can be affected by that. And going down like this, it's rough if you lose that first game in the best of three. You kind of have to rally yourself to come back in, and this is a single elimination. So they lose two games, you're out, and really both of these teams probably feeling that pressure.
Yeah, I mean, as you said, they're paying their respects to each other. Calvin College knows what Bowling Green is capable of, and vice versa. That's why we saw the respect Serket ban earlier on in the draft. Ajax just performed so well on it yesterday that Bowling Green knew that they needed to take it off the map. Exactly what they did. Now we're seeing a little bit of aggression in the mid lane. Veznar forced to jump over the wall so he couldn't take too much more poke from Ajax there. But right now, everybody's hitting that level 5 slash line, except for King Med on this Huiyi. He should be hitting it here with this wave. Indeed, he will be. So now everybody just kind of evenly farming out each other here. But Calvin getting a very, very small gold lead that's just been building up.
Yeah, and that's going to be playing a very big role as they move forward. And really, I'm looking at them. They're level 5, going to be very strong. We do see a lot of counter-initiation for Bowling Green, but I'm expecting Illy to play this Bacchus as aggressive as possible. One of the things I like about Intoxicate is the fact that Bacchus, he sacrifices a little bit of tank early on, but he gets a big chunk of damage off of that AoE. And of course, it's one of the most infuriating CCs in Smite. I had the same making everything wobble as we're going to be seeing on the solo lane. They might not go too well. Terra looking to be able to dash away, gets that double dash, no problem. Should be able to just escape under the tower without it.
Yeah, Illy's gonna provide a little bit of poke with that belch into the belly flop, but not gonna really do too much. Dwarfwood gonna be able to heal that up, no problem for himself. Elemental Gremlin's gonna be dropping in favor of Bowling Green, just giving themselves a little bit of farm. And as we said, the gold, very small lead in favor of Calvin College. Athletics about 400 or 500. But however, first initiation of the fight is gonna be end up being a wash because of that ultimate from Ajax to be able to get himself out of danger there. So two big ultimates, actually three ultimates. Okay, King Med used it over on the left-hand side. So two ultimates to try and get Ajax, but really nothing to avail from it.
Yeah, right now, I feel like Coco Scone's not quite having the mid fight that he really has been wanting. I've been watching his health bar, and he's been sitting below half health for a big chunk of this game, and I feel like that's going to be changing a little bit as we see the Medusa come a little bit more online overall, sitting in that like kind of 7 to 12 range when she starts to shine a little bit brighter. Her clear becomes full and she's able to kind of make those rotations that you would want. But, I mean, three big ultimates offline just to get, I mean, and force the execute out. So they don't have to worry about Ajax coming crashing down and killing their tanks easily, but they still have to worry about Ajax being who he is, and everyone else on Calvin still has that ultimate. As right now, that'll be smitten. Gonna get ganked out, stunned out, but he's a pretty tanky Xing Shen, and he doesn't seem too worried by this, especially because his team is in the neighborhood.
Yeah, gonna be able to pick up Dwarfwood, throw him under the tower. Dash is available, and Toxicate's gonna come out. The heal from Terra's Blessing is gonna be good, but it's not gonna be quite good enough. Actually, he's gonna be able to get out of there thanks to the great stun. Veznar making the rotation over on this Fafnir, and the wall's gonna come down from Cax Sanctum. Ajax in a bad spot, but he's gonna be able to get that heal with the Death Scythe, and yet again, another wash of a gank. Nobody dying in this case.
Like, Door of Wood just blew me away. Like, hitting the three-man stun there, that was the only way for him to get out. Had anyone been able to continue that pursuit, he would have either been CC'd or at least enough damage to slow him down, keep him in combat, and force him to take the fight. But hitting all three of them with that, allowing him to get right on out of there and stay safe, essentially go back, heal up, come back into this lane like it's nothing. And being able to turn that on its head, I mean, not letting Calvin get those picks like they want is keeping that gold lead just around. I mean, Calvin's still farming a little bit more efficiently overall right now, but it's only about 400 gold, so it's not making a huge difference in the game so far.
No, and when you take a look into the mid lane, I mean, you're going to have a Scotty versus Medusa in the later stage of the game. Let that be as you will. Scotty will have that ability to split push. Actually takes a huge death scythe from Ajax there as it's starting to hit that third, fourth rank. That death scythe's going to really start chunking these squishy targets. over on the left side. Empyrean still getting the better end of King Med here, but that's really just the power of the on her in these early levels versus OG. Not quite as impactful. Ajax gonna get a little bit aggressive over here on the left hand side, but gonna be turned onto by Caxton. Force gonna be used to execute yet again. Dragon form and the walls are gonna come out, but once again, two ultimates to try and get Ajax, and he's just gonna be able to get away.
And being able to fly on out of there and land back, and with his passive with the Bumba's Mask as well, he's going to be able to heal up no problem, so it's not a big deal for him. And of course, Thanatos not using so much mana. It should be, I mean, in a comfortable position to kind of re-engage, but without that execute, that is going to be a safe spot for all three of those Guardians. It's going to stop him from having such an easy time really going into this, and really it's looking like now the gank on the duo might do something. Is the knockup going to be good? The ult coming out from the on her. The stun not going to come through as we see the burp tick its last one, stopping this Kabrakan from being able to get anything. And now they're just going to have to fall back. And so far, every single gank has been turned around on. And both of these teams, I mean, they're playing at the top of their abilities right now.
Yeah, I mean, they're going as well as they can. But the problem is for Ajax, he just, as soon as he gets engaged on, he goes into the air. He's able to get out of it just as quickly as they engage onto him. And as far as everywhere else, I mean, Empyrean had the mindset of, it's a Kabrakan, you know, I'm not sure if his walls are back up yet, so I just need to make sure to get away as quick as possible. Turns around to avoid the stun by using that Desert Fury. Now he's just going to continue the aggression in the left-hand side, continue trying to poke out King Med as best as he can. And really, I mean, as you said, it's just very slow. It doesn't seem like it's a slow-paced game with how much action we've seen, but no kills on the board in almost 8.5 minutes.
And not only 8.5 minutes in are there no kills, but we're sitting, I mean, 161 gold is separating these teams right now, and that's going to fluctuate to essentially 30 between the two teams based on wave to wave and jungle camps. And it's about 500 experience right now in favor of Bowling Green, but that one still fluctuating back and forth between wave to wave just because of the way this game is going. They've essentially made this far. They've gone 9 minutes in, and all of them are still dead even with all of the action we've seen. We haven't seen a single first blood come out yet, but that might be happening now. Coco's going to get stunned out. The trimmer's going to be good, but he's going to be able to turn around, get that petrify, and they're looking possibly for the execute to come back in. But Coco Scones is going to be the first one to fall in this game, and that's going to be first blood for Bowling Green.
Unfortunate for the Medusas, they have no way to get around those walls, and Caxton doing the perfect job of laying those to where he had no escape but towards his team. Now Gold Fury gonna be started up, four members strong over here. Tear the only one not there, and Illy gonna be the next one to fall in the engagement. Empyrean's gonna be able to turn around. Valby Smitten's gonna throw a three against the wall, be able to jump out in time, and Empyrean just doing his best to continue the boxing match here, but he's fighting the essential 4v1 there as Calder is still available to them. Gonna be able to dissuade them from the Gold Fury for just a little while, but they're gonna turn their eyes right back to it.
And now sitting about half health, I like seeing where Ajax is. I like seeing where Empyrean is. Both of them looking to possibly come in and try to steal this one away. Waiting patiently, going to go forward. Bowling Green going to be able to confirm that. Now just trying to find the cleanup, but getting locked down where he is. Ajax not able to do anything. Turn that around, get up the Oracles, but ultimately losing that Gold Fury. Bowling Green with that, take this game from even to the lead.
Yeah, with about a 1,600 gold advantage now with that Gold Fury and the two kills that proceeded with it from that first blood gold that's so valuable. Now, Calvin College taking their eyes over towards the Portal Demon. Dorvoid, the only one in the area at the moment. Gonna try and throw out those abilities, see what he can do. But Dorn needs to be able to get in there as quick as possible to get that dashed off, but doesn't matter. They're gonna destroy out the Monolith. Terra's Blessings coming out. Two more members rotating in. It's the Guardians versus the rest of the team. They're gonna be able to secure that Portal Demon for Calvin College. Now they're gonna be on the retreat as Kogus Guns uses that Petrify. Only hits Veznar. And now Kogus Guns forced to use that Purification Beads. The Monolith actually gonna block Veznar from continuing too much forward, but Ajax not gonna make it out of the one. Caxton's gonna get the credit for that kill. Valby Smitten's just gonna throw the rest of the team away.
And right now, Illy trying to run away as well. That three-man pickup from the Xing Chen could have been great, but with the rest of the team falling the way they did, not going to risk losing any more of his members as they were all sitting a little bit below half health. And now it's looking like we're going to see Bowling Green. I mean, they're turning this one into a tower. They're going to continue this aggression that they've been able to pick up. And honestly, this is going to be a steamroll. And the composition they have is set up to essentially just give them three big frontliners. We're going to see Kabrakan, who, I mean, there's a reason people call him Fat Loki. He has a ton of damage. Plus two hunters, they are the objective killers right here. And letting them get ahead right now, Calvin, like, they're on a slippery slope. They still have potential to bring it back, though.
Yeah, I mean, especially with that Fafnir, you're talking about objective killers. Fafnir, one of the best guardians in the game, if not the best one at helping to kill objectives with that AoE course in his draconic form. He's going to be able to allow these hunters to attack so much faster and provide a ton of extra damage. That's not only going to help Scotty, that's going to help Calder out as well. Going to allow Calder to attack faster alongside his master Scotty there, but We'll see just how that continues forward into the game. First tower has been dropped in the mid lane. It's going to give Bowling Green just a little bit more slight of a lead, bringing them... Actually, it's essentially still about the same pace it was, about 1,600. So just the efficient farming from Calvin College is really keeping them in this game.
And the big one really right now is going to be the 2,400 experience that Bowling Green has been able to pick up, and just having that kind of level difference. A lot of that is going to be sitting in the two level difference in the supports right now, because as we can see, like, the mid laner Coco Scones is sitting a little bit above the Scotty, but overall level advantage going to be in favor of Bowling Green, and keeping up with that is going to be not necessarily the hardest thing for Calvin here, but they're going to have to focus on it. And I love Ajax a lot right now, only because he recognizes three Guardians means a lot of tank, and he is going immediately into the Titan's main to get that penetration.
Yeah, he's going to try and provide himself as much penetration as possible, but he's going to get walled up immediately into the execute yet again to try and get away from this tanky team. He is on full retreat here. Dursic is available for the execute, but it doesn't matter. Empyrean's going to snag that kill. Still blocked off because of the walls. Nobody has killed them off yet. Draconic Form going to land onto two, and now Hoyi's made the rotation in. Illy is going to be trapped under the suns. Not going to be able to get out of here, and Empyrean's going to fall as well. That's another two kills. Ajax, who was coming back in, is going to be the next one to fall. Double kill for Caxtum on this Kraken.
Coco Scones being able to dash away there at the tail end of that. And right now, it seems like Bowling Green are a little bit unsure of where exactly they want to go. It looks like they want to push down this tier one on left. And they have all rights. So, I mean, no one on Calvin is making the rotation over. They know that it's probably not worth defending for their life. I do like to see Coco Scones maybe try and defend the tier two instead of just letting them steamroll. But with the way it's going right now, with only one Hunter and three Guardians, that tower is taking a long time to fall. So I have a feeling it's going to go in favor of Calvin overall, just because they stopped from losing everything on this left-hand side.
I mean, Bowling Green is prioritizing the perfect targets here. Thanatos is going to be the problem for us in the late game. Well, we're just going to make sure Thanatos can never do anything, can never get those executes off. We're going to continue to bully this Thanatos, make sure he can't get ahead. He's now sitting two levels down compared to Caxtum on this Kraken. They're going to turn their eyes over to the Oracle Harpies, pick those ones up. No problem there. And as you said, the experience is what's really going to start hurting Calvin College as they get much stronger with levels, sitting about 4,000 experience down right now.
Yeah, and finally being able to kind of extend themselves, Bowling Green finding that 3,000 gold lead, kind of pushing it past that threshold where now they can be a little bit more comfortable. They're not super far ahead where they can risk everything, but they're far enough ahead that these fights that they take, if they lose one person, especially if it's one of the two Guardians that I'm looking at, maybe Dora Wood or Vesnar, it's not as big a deal as it could be because they have someone to come in for the backup. As right now, we're going to see Zurek just get erased off the map. Empyrean, tired of letting this Scotty run rampant, able to finally get another kill for his team right there. All three of them sitting on his back right now, and he's starting to load up that backpack and see if his team's big enough to fit in it.
Yeah, and he's on his way to get that Hasten Fatalis, has the tier 2 of it right now, and that's going to add a lot of extra damage into his kit, allow him to chase down his opponents, give him some extra movement speed and attack speed to boot, but more than anything, add that penetration as well to start taking down some of these tankier Guardians. As you can see, all three of them have already built into some form of physical defense right now. Caxtum not quite fully finished up on his likely Breastplate of Valor, though it could potentially be anemia in line with the double Hunter comp that's come out here. We'll see exactly what he wants to prioritize into that one. But more than anything, being able to just get away from these Guardians and from the rest of this team is what Calvin College needs to look at.
And right now, I'm looking at the objectives respawning. Fire Giant still available from when it spawned. Both Holden and Gold Fairy both back up right now. Coco Scone is going to get taken down in the mid lane. Return kill from earlier on. They do not want to let their mid lane die without your mid lane dying. And right now, the 0-2-0 Medusa not quite having the same impact as the 0-2-4 Scotty. And when we look at impact, I'm looking at this Gold Fairy right now. Vesnar immediately going into the dragon form, getting that AoE coerce so they can just try to burn this down as fast as they can. And it seems like Calvin, they know better. They're not even going to bother trying to go into that, but they do turn their eyes immediately onto this portal.
Yeah, they're going to be able to get this one down. Not really fastly, however. It's a little too slow for them. They realize that, and they're going to have to deter away from that one as the Draconic Form is still available, and Bowling Green going to immediately turn tail onto it. Terra's Blessing used as well to make sure they can get over as quick as possible. Portal Demon going to actually be stolen away by the Desert Fury. Calvin College going to give themselves a small objective win. They're going to pay with Illy's life. King Med's going to pick up that one. Ajax trying to do what he can, but they're so tanky, and he doesn't have any massive penetration to break through these tanky Guardians right now. So they trade one in exchange for stealing away the Portal Demon.
Now, you know, a while ago, I want to say in Season 2 of Smite was when it was really shining, but there was a thing called the Unicorn build, which was really big on eating through protections and towers, and I kind of want to see the two hunters that they have on Calvin, possibly even Ajax a little bit, go for that, just to try and eat through these tanky targets. Something similar to that would be very good, as right now, half health is Valby Smith. Getting locked up in those tremors, going to be able to get a little bit of a root, but he's slowed down. Now he's going to be going for the round and round, throwing people back, but he is one hit away. The Petrify, though, going to be able to connect on the two. There's just not a ton of damage coming out from Calvin. The bead's going to be forced. Ajax trying to run away, but he gets stunned out. The tremor's going to be good, and he's going to fall down anyway.
Caxton going to use the early purification beads to make sure that he doesn't get knocked up into the air by Illy and potentially cause the death of him. Empyrean recognizes that there are five members on the right-hand side, and he's going to make his way over to the tier 2 tower on the left lane. Going to be able to get that down probably at least about half HP before anybody can stop him. Already got it down to half, going to continue the aggression onto it as nobody is here quick enough. King Med not going to be able to make it in time to save this tier 2 tower, so they're going to trade tower for tower, but Calvin College lost 2 in that last engagement, and that's going to be a big downfall for them.
And right now, missing 2 tier 1s in the mid and long lane for Calvin College, whereas we still see 4 towers standing fully for Bowling Green. Empyrean not able to confirm those Oracle Harpies, just a nice blink in and steal from the Bracken one more time. And again, this is just kind of what it is. It's 10 kills to 3, 18 minutes in, and Bowling Green, I mean, while a little bit of a dent in that gold because of the tier 2 that Empyrean was able to pick up, they're still up 4,300 gold and about 6,000 experience all across the board. And they're just looking to kind of carry this forward. Again, 3 kills for Calvin, all on the back of Empyrean, who wasn't even in that last fight.
Yeah, I mean, when we talk about free gold more than anything else in the towers, I mean, if you take a look, it's 2 tier 2s versus 2 tier 2s, 2 tier 1s. So there's really only 1,000 gold that is still available for Calvin College to essentially even out. So while it may be a 4K gold difference, you can kind of see it as a 3,000 with those 2 tier 1s still available for them. But over on the right-hand side, Valby Smitten going to be able to pick up his blue buff. Empyrean doing what he can, seeing what is available for him. He is level 17, needs to be careful. Good Impale's going to get him away from the Kraken for now, but he's going to be walled off as his jump is on cooldown. Going to get stuck, going to be forced to use that Aegis to get away from the damage from Caxup and the Dragon Form, but it doesn't matter. Mesnar comes crashing down. A good Petrify is going to stun 2 of them, but that's just going to be the disengage from Bowling Green. They're going to wait for the rest of their team to show up before they re-engage into this team.
Right now, though, it looks like Bowling Green have a bigger target set on their mind, turning their eyes immediately to this Fire Giant. And again, Tawaris in the Dragon form going to be able to give them all a little bit AoE damage boost going forward. But honestly, this could be a good bait or a good spot for Illy, but he's going to use that Intoxicate onto 3 of the members right now, trying to take a lot of damage. We're going to see Dalby Smith throw them back. And again, very tanky target's not going to go down. The execute range is Vesnar, but the heal's going to be good out of all of them. Illy going to fall down. The 3-man stun, but the Sunster drop, and that is going to be Ajax's death. Dalby Smith probably the next on the docket as he gets burnt down. The trimmer's going to be good. Zurek getting that one. And 2 members strong left for Calvin, trying to do anything, but they are only hunters. They do not have a big health pool. And really, they're just going to have to wait and hopefully try to steal away this Fire Giant for their team.
Yeah, I mean, none of them have the kin size either online, so they can't even really shred through these tanky targets. Caxton just going to be a little bit off the mark with those walls, and they're just trying to do what they can to zone out these hunters. The Fire Giant is still being held onto at the moment. King Med has the aggro onto it, but now Bowling Green forced to back off of it just because they can't safely take this Fire Giant with both of these hunters available. Neither of them have their ultimates at the moment, but they're just too scared of the potential steal that can come out from Calvin.
I'll be honest, in that last engagement, I think what I would have rather seen come out from Calvin is, instead of getting that team fight, put Illy in a position that he can belly flop over the wall and use that Intoxicate. Because one thing that people kind of underestimate is how much damage it can do. And when it comes down to stealing objectives, I feel like Bacchus is one of the top supports to do it. I kind of expect to possibly see that play a role in the future coming up soon, as Gold Fury, Portal Demon are going to be respawning. Illy is going to have that available to him now. And if Fire Giant gets started up, even if it's just a bait, I expect to see Calvin again try to go for that, as we see Dragon Form going to be used once again for the AoE Coerce. Well, it's only going to hit King Med right now. Now they're going to turn their aggression on the Coco Scones.
Wow, and he's taking a lot of damage just from the dots of the Dragon. Going to put him down to almost death there as he's walking away with only about 100 or so HP. Now that's going to make the 4v5. Vesnar's still going to have that Dragon Form for about another 15 seconds or so before it's going to wear off. Maybe a little bit less. He's waiting for that next big course to come off. There's the Coerce waiting for the big initiation. Going to take down that ward and figure out who they want to go on here. He's going to cancel out that Draconic Form early, and I do respect the decision on that one. They're not making any use of it now, so go ahead and make sure you get on earlier for the next fight. Blink onto Empyrean. gonna do a lot of damage, taking down to about half HP. Round and round's gonna come through. That was Vince gonna throw only one into that one. The Suns are gonna come crashing. They got the two squishy members low, but unfortunately the Aegis is gonna be good enough to keep the Zerg alive until that be Smitten's gonna pick him up. Kaxxedem gonna pick up Empyrean, and now the full retreat as King Med sitting just under half HP, but three members standing in the middle of the four of Calvin College. The knockup is gonna be good. Kaxxedem gonna be put very low and is gonna be taken down. That be Smitten gonna be able to get the shutdown onto the Kabrakan.
They're finally able to pick up some other kills right there throughout their team, but still cutting it relatively close. I mean, losing Empyrean isn't as big a deal as it could have been, being able to kind of finally pick up two kills and bring them to their team right back into the fight, but not able to get any objectives off it. And that's going to be the big thing for Bowling Green, is that they're not really losing much for it. They do lose their jungler and their mid laner, and with the lead they have, that's not something very comfortable, especially now looking at the 7-2-7 Kabrakan. But really, they're still in a position to continue the fight. They still have the lead. They still have control of the game, and they can kind of force Calvin to play their pace.
Yeah, and looking over at Ajax, he's been forced to go into a very early Bulwark of Hope as well, going into the Cloak, which could possibly be the Spirit Robe. He's been getting CC'd very heavily, and getting that extra damage mitigation will be able to really help him out into these fights. So we'll see just exactly how that item plays out for him. But when you got your Thanatos going into very early defense because of this triple Guardian comp that's come out from Bowling Green, I mean, they're playing it to the T at this point. They're not letting Ajax get any big executes off. They're making sure to force out his ultimate every single time they engage onto him. So really, the two big ultimates that we've seen from Ajax have come out with nothing. We had an Aegis come out in the last one, and the last time that he jumped down onto three targets, they were all too tanky and nothing was able to come of it. Bowling Green's going to be able to get the Gold Fury in response to Calvin College. Gonna try and sneak away this portal demon, but they don't really have a lot of damage right now. Ajax, the only big damage dealer for them.
Yeah, trying to get that one down. They've actually been fighting this for quite some time. Coco's Scones getting caught out in the mid lane. They're possibly going to be trading him out for this. The Aegis not going to be good enough to save his life. The Silas will be coming through, spinning around, forcing the beads. The Suns are going to come down. Ajax taking a lot of damage, barely up in the sky. And now Illy looking to be in the worst position of them all, stunned out, taking some damage. Ajax going to miss the stun completely, now taking a little bit more damage. One more auto finds that kill for Bowling Green right here, and now Calvin on a full retreat, trying to get away, already lost two of their members. Illy going to go down one more time. Now that'll be Smith looking to be the next main target. CC'd a little bit of damage, would be able to find it. The tier two is a little bit more important, and Bowling Green recognized objectives over kills, and they're going to be able to get that, and now extend their lead even further here at the 24-minute mark.
One thing we didn't even talk about was the Stone of Binding on the side of Kaxxedem on the Skabrakan. That's going to provide an AoE penetration to his team. They're going to pop that shell as they engage into this mid lane Phoenix. They've got enough damage with the double Hunter plus Veznar on that Fafnir, allowing them to provide even more damage. The Empyrean forced to jump away. Calder's going to be on the chase, but it's not going to be enough to take him down. As Bowling Green is going to count their victories, count their Terra's blessings more than anything else, be able to retreat back into the jungle, steal away these buffs, and maybe even look towards the Fire Giant.
That's actually a really big point. That entire last engagement was sans Fire Giant for Bowling Green. They were able to confirm Tier 2 and the Phoenix like it was nothing, even though they didn't have that nice buff allowing them to eat through it, like, I mean, as easily as they could. And especially, again, comboed with the Fafnir, comboed with all the items that they're about to buy off of the gold they just earned, they're looking to be in a very good spot to continue sieges either down the right-hand or left-hand side. And I'm assuming they're probably going to look over towards that left-hand side, assuming they get the Fire Giant just to get rid of that last tier two standing for Calvin College. But the big fight is going to be standing right around here, and there's still a lot of steal potential for Calvin as long as they don't burn those ultimates before in a team fight. But sometimes they just have to do that. Really, right now, they haven't been in a position to engage. They're always doing the counter engage, and it just hasn't been working out for them.
Yeah, I mean, that's always been a problem with Calvin College, is their objective secure, their objective mindset has always been fairly weak compared to some of the other teams. I mean, that's how they lost against Southwestern, was they went for an objective steal, forcing out a Hoon, using their Hoonbot's ultimate and the Desert Fury. They had no follow-up initiation after, got a five-man wipe out of it, ended up falling to Southwestern in that first game. And then the second one, they could not secure the Fire Giant. Then the preceding team fight yet again right afterward was what caused them their loss there. Fire Giant being started up here. The Draconic form has not even come out, and the Fire Giant's already at half HP. They're waiting for somebody to make the first mistake. That'll be Smitten and Illy on the front line right now, but they're just two tanks right now, and they're not going to be able to do too much, as now the chase is down onto the Hunters.
One more time, Illy getting caught out, trying to stay alive as fast as he can, but he's not going to be able to make it out with his life there. As we see, again, a lot of poke getting put down. Ajax going to be the main target right here. The Sun's coming down one more time. Aegis going to be able to keep him alive. Vestar getting low, but not going to go down. We see Ajax go in the air. He wants an execute, but he can't really engage where he is right now. Going to become crashing down. Zira going to be able to pick up that kill, turning around, trying to get Door of Wood right now. This is the fight that Calvin needs to go forward. After losing Illy, they're going to be looking Vestar low. Catscon going to get the return kill onto Coco Skills. And now with Vestar falling, they're going to have two frontliners down, but there's still a Kabragan, there's still a Hu Yi. And while they're trying to kill it, the Fire Giant doing a little bit of damage and fire minions pouring into the base.
Oh, that's not good. Illy has respawned. He's going to be able to try and deter these fire minions for as long as possible, but he is just a tanky box. He doesn't quite have enough damage into his kit. So you can see just the Belch and the belly buff only took the minions down to half, and they are shredding through this Titan right now, and all of that damage is going to remain there because no god took the aggro from it. So it's unfortunate that it's just gonna be sitting there, but Common College is gonna be able to hold it off just for now. No Fire Giant taken, and more than anything, that was the fight that Calvin College needed. They turned up. They only lost to one member from that one, Coco,
and they were able to get Illy early on.
And then Illy very, very early on there. So they traded out 2 for 3 in that engagement. Ajax now starting to come online. Did opt to go to that Spirit Robe. Now can look to go towards maybe another big penetration item that he may need. Probably something like a Jotun's Wrath wouldn't be too bad. Give him a little bit of extra cooldown reduction. That 20% can do wonders for you as a Thanatos. It means more death sights, more silences, and then more than anything, more executes.
I'm interested. I mean, looking at the builds all across the board for Bowling Green, I mean, earlier we mentioned the Stone of Binding. I'm always a big fan of that, especially on someone like Kabrakan, who has a ton of CC. But looking down, I'm actually seeing the Gauntlet of Thebes picked up, and while it's only going to give him health and 15 HP hive for Vesnar, that's giving a lot of protection. I mean, just 20, but to everyone on his team, and with two other Guardians standing up right there, that is going to allow them to just live even further on. He's had this for a little bit there, and that's kind of been another thorn in the side, really, for Calvin. That has to be the phrase of the day for them, just because they aren't quite able to do anything. And I like that Thalby Smitten's response to the double hunter is to pick up this hide of the Nemean, but it just seems like it's not being able to do quite as much. Portal Nemean confirmed by Bowling Green, and it looks like, again, we might see Imperium or someone get caught out here.
Yeah, he's going to be able to get the Impale onto him, but it's not going to be enough. He's going to be sitting at about half HP. Illy going to jump into the back onto the two Hunters to see what he can do, but he is just a box at the time. Forced to actually make the long path back, and this could be the downside of Calvin College. No, Illy means Empyrean is going to be the first one to fall. Trying to get a team away from him is now be smitten with the washing machine, but it's not going to be enough. He is going to be knocked around. He is going to fall to the jump from King Med, and that's two members down now on the side of Calvin College. With Illy taking the pathing that he did, he was not able to help peel for his team, and now that's going to leave the Fire Giant open for Bowling Green to take for free.
Now, this is one of the spots where it really does kind of fall back and forth. If Illy had been able to turn around and hover around there, might have been able to jump in, steal away the Fire Giant just to stop Bowling Green from getting it. But at the same time, it was equally likely for them to just stop aggro on the Fire Giant and burst down Illy, and losing that third member they have defending would just have been another big detriment for them. But right now, Bowling Green sitting in the driver's seat for the game, 9,000 gold, 8,500 experience so far. And really, I mean, 21-8 sitting at 30 minutes. They are slowly but surely pushing themselves to find that victory. Now with five members having that Fire Giant, soon to be another Gold Fury on their side, I expect to see them retake that mid Phoenix and probably push down this left-hand side to get rid of that last tier two for Calvin.
I mean, I just love what's coming out of Bowling Green's team here is what they've built on their Guardians to provide for their team. They have the Stone of Binding to give them an aura penetration. They have the Lotus Crown, so whenever Terra gets that heal up, it's going to provide extra physical protections and magical protection on top of that. It's going to provide 20 of each on top of the 20 that you're getting from Gauntlet of Thebes, each one. 30 physical protections from Sovereignty and the 20 from Hardware. But hold that thought, Dirzik gonna be able to pick up Empyrean as he was trying to defend that tier 2 tower. Not really worth the trade out there as he's gonna take his fourth spill of the game. But just what Bowling Green is providing for each other, penetration and more than anything, massive protections. It's so difficult for Calvin College to do anything to this team.
Yeah, they are the shield for their hunters right now and doing a great job at it. And especially when it comes down to, I mean, we mentioned it earlier, Kabrakan having a big impact. Fat Loki himself showing up, doing the damage he needs, the CC machine that they've wanted. But really, the walls, the ults that he has had, he has been catching Coco Scones out every single time he goes to dash and has been working out for them so well. And now Mid Phoenix again going to be under aggression. Should fall no problem, especially since it's already fallen once. And they have the Fire Giant Belt that allows Bowling Green to kind of turn their aggression anywhere they want. They're going to be looking over here to the left hand Phoenix. We're going to see Petrify come out, but now minions pouring in. The Titan's going to take a little bit of extra damage, but Trevor's going to come down. The walls once again being very good. Illy taking a lot of poke in the beginning, going to fall down to the Calder right there. Coco's trying to get away, but the dash from Calder going to confirm the double kill right there. And Calvin on full retreat, trying to make it back to their fountain. And Kyrian forced to Aegis just to get out. The stun's going to be good, and the damage is going to be good. A triple kill for Zurek right here at the end of the game, trying to push that even further. But the Titan is the main target, and that is going to be what they are looking for.
Yeah, or maybe looking for that. Be Smitten King Med going to be able to pick him up, and the Titan going to be the next target taken down. Bowling Green, despite their loss yesterday, has turned it on its head and now has put Calvin College at a deficit, picking up their first win in this best of three.
Yeah, needing only one more to really secure this one out and move forward in the Gauntlet stage. But Calvin are not out yet. They do still have at least one more game to try and bring themselves back and try and find this reverse sweep totally that they would like. And honestly, I think it's going to come down one more time to picks and bans and maybe trying to focus a little bit. I mean, Thanatos is great, but that just got shut down very, very hard early on. And Bowling Green, I mean, they read exactly what Calvin College was trying to do, and they did not let them get away with it.
Yeah, I mean, they were fine getting rid of the Serket and leaving this Thanatos open. And by picking up this triple super protective Guardian strat that they have, Terra and Kabrakan, more than anything, they have the more aggressive style Guardian coming out of Vesnar's Fafnir. But the way that he played it was not, you know, the big, massive initiator at all times. It was really the stay in the back line, see what I can provide for my hunters, provide to them that AoE course in the dragon form, and just keep them alive where it catches them on that Kabrakan. He was the big factor in that game. 27,000 player damage on this Kabrakan. And that's a very absurd number when you think about what kind of a god this is. This is a Guardian. They're not supposed to do this kind of craziness damage. But, I mean, here we are with a Kabrakan. I mean, and looking at his build, too. He built what you can call hybrid. He built that E-Staff as one of his big items. I mean, what do you do against this Kabrakan?
Honestly, when it came down to it, you just hope you can burst him down or ban him out at this next stage. I mean, 10 to 16, obviously having a large impact. And like you said, just building very, very well, being able to get the extra damage he needed while staying as tanky as he could be and leading the way for his team. But I also want to highlight a little bit. I mean, King Med was 8-0-13 early on. He didn't really call his name out, but he was top gold per minute in the game, king of the farm over there. And then late game, as he transitioned over, dropping those stuns, being able to hit the ricochets he did, getting that extra bit of damage, which plays very well with the walls thrown out by the Kabrakan. Overall, Bowling Green just having a very synergistic team and able to kind of abuse that as full as they could and focus the right targets. Honestly, I think for Calvin, the next step might just be to ban out that Kabrakan.
Yeah, I think that's going to be their big priority ban this time around. Not banning out that very awkward, in my opinion, Ratatosker. The Hoonbot's ban was fine, but leaving this Kabrakan open just so that way they could have the option to try and get the Thanatos just didn't end up working out for them. We'll see if Calvin College can bounce back into this next game. So go into a brief break. We'll be back with the second game.